show you what performance you achieved, they'll show you your the fee that you paid, and then they'll say the average LGPS fund paid this fee, and they'll say, you know, the average private pension fund paid this fee. They also categorise by size, so they, you know, they have a large number of funds that they do this sort of reporting for, so they can compare you against equivalently sized funds, so that you don't look at yourself against small funds and say, aren't we doing a great job? You look at yourself against equivalently sized funds in both the private and public sector, you know, it could be Dutch pension funds, Canadian pension funds, UK pension funds, and you can see that for whatever asset class it is, the fee that you're paying is in line or out of line, either better or worse. So it's very helpful because you can then concentrate on the areas where you appear to be paying more than other pension funds and do something about it. So that's very helpful in the sense the more funds that you see, and the better their database and the more useful the information. So they provide information both at a fund level and a pool level. So we've agreed as the Northern Pool that we'll make use of CEM, we've used them in the past. So they produce a fund by fund report, but then you can look at the pool as a whole as well. So that gives a lot of context and a lot of information, and that's how we make use of it. But you know, it's incumbent on us to provide that information to CEM. They actually do some verification, so that if they think you're submitting data that looks out of line with what they'd expect, they do come back to you and say, this looks funny. What arrangement have you got or haven't got? So it's I think it's a very robust process. And they are now on the national framework, so it's much easier for LGPS funds to make use of them if they want to. Yes, there is just the short report that went to committee on the 21st of March, which informs members that we had received a response, a formal response from the Minister for Local Government. The call considered the Minister's letter and prepared a response, and then a workshop was held on the 28th of March, which was attended by each of the funds in the pool, and there was a useful conversation around the implications of FCA regulation and the legal and financial costs of pooling.
One small one. Two or three, Peter. Our advisor to the fund.
Oh, that was Noel and Rowan.
It's Noel and Rowan, yes. That's what I thought.
This is the annual report that is required to be prepared according to the terms of reference. And this report needs to be considered by the scheme manager, which is the Rural MBC Pensions Committee, following consideration by the board and approval of a version the board is content with. I have prepared the report myself, and the version that you approve will go, I think, now to the Pensions Committee on the 17th of July.
That's the intention. Yeah.
So the intention is that we'll go on the 17th of July and I will present whatever you approve to the Pensions Committee and be questioned by them. I won't go through it all, but if you turn to page 88, board meetings, you'll see under there the agenda items at each board. I think overall it's pleasing to note that the attendance by board members was 88%. I know we had a vacancy for a while, and that's why it comes to 88%, because if you do the maximum, I think, of 9 board members, they can have 88%. It does work, because we did have a vacancy for a few. But again, like the previous year, when you're sitting at IA, I think that's absolutely excellent, and it again shows the commitments of the members of this board. We put into place, on that table, the actual work plan, which you recall was prepared following discussions between the director and myself and consultation with all of yourselves. and the work plan, I think, had quite focused on a number of issues, particularly governance issues, but particularly pensions admin, and two pensions admin reports came, as been suggested in the work plan, and I think they were very well received, and we're now getting, going forward, I suppose we're getting pensions admin report every quarter. I think it's absolutely essential because this board consists of employers and employees, and it's in the interest of both employers and employees that pensions admin works as smoothly as possible. So I think that's very positive that that's happening. The development inflation of Prawley, I think, is probably the largest and highest profile development in the LGPS. We've received reports at all three meetings. They were extremely detailed, and I think the provision of information, much of which necessarily had to be in the exempt agenda, as it was at the pension committee, I think has helped to reassure us that the three funds are seeking to put into place a pooling solution which meets both the Secretary of State's requirements and the specific requirements of three individual funds. And these funds are very different than most of the other funds in the LGPS. You know, these are really professional funds with a lot of internal management. I think we have received a lot of assurance from those reports that what is being proposed is genuinely focused. We did have this governance focus, and we continue to receive the minutes of the working parties. Again, we have a lot of detailed work goes on. And again, we are invited to attend those as observers. We need to speak to Derek about attendance, but again, I think that's very positive. I think again, in 16, 17, as in 15, 16, everyone did contribute positive debates. I do like to mention here again, sad that I feel good with him because Phil did make a very positive contribution to this board during the previous year, and I think I'd just like to acknowledge that today. Perhaps I could go in the minutes again because Phil was a very positive member of this board. It was very sad that he left us before we would have wished. Training development, this again I think was taken seriously by both the administering authority and members of the board. Each meeting last year considered training and development. And I think it was excellent that in particular three members attended the full 3-day LGPS fundamentals training. Because this really is a course that often only elected members go to. And the fact that three of the 18 members here actually went and did all 3 days, I think it actually says an awful lot. And I don't think that will be common across pension boards. And that is very, I think, impressive. And I know that five members actually attended conference events organised by the PLSA. I think that's five members excluding myself. So again, I think that's pretty impressive. We had a good representation at the annual employers conference where 6 out of 8 members attended. And that, again, is a really good event where we learn, I think, as a board, and employers learn as well, an awful lot about the governance, the investment administration of the fund. The cost of the operation of the board are reported there between the 1st of April 2016 and 31st of March 2017. I think the training cost there of £10,500, but that is well worth it because we are under very heavy statutory requirements both in primary legislation and in secondary legislation and in guidance. And the pensions regulator is, I think, fascinated by what's going on in terms of member training and keeps asking questions. And it is important that the training is done, and therefore I think that cost is very justifiable. Below is the proposed work plan for 2017-18, and basically it's been put together by the director and myself based on what was agreed last year, and I hope that members will be content with that. If anyone has any other suggestions, please do, but the work plan will be updated as necessary. So if you can do any suggestions come forward during 2017-18. And again, two items there, administration KPI report and pooling update. There will be reports at each meeting this year, because those two items I think are absolutely crucial to the whole sort of governance of the fund. Turning to the final page, the effectiveness of the board isn't just dependent on the members, it depends on the administering authority. And again, I would like to place on record the positive support and guidance we received from the officers of the Merseyside Fund, from the director and also the senior members of his team, Yvonne, Donna, also a talk there from Guy and from Emma, and from the other members of staff, particularly, I was going to come to the Administration Authority itself in a minute, at the employers' conference, because I've been very impressed by the way that staff at that conference handle that and deal with that conference and the welcome we get and the efficiency of that. It is also pertinent to mention, actually, Joe's attendance here as managing director, did we? One of the questions we were asked in that survey was about have any members of the Administration Authority attended the board meetings? Well, I could answer yes, because a senior member of the Administration Authority outside of the fund staff, the direct fund staff, is attending. I do wonder how many boards will be able to answer that positively and say yes. So that is very positive. So on behalf of the board, I would like to thank the officers for their positive approach and reports and the guidance and advice that we've received. Really, I'd just like to invite any questions to me or comments from other board members or amendments to this report, because remember, the approved version will go forward to the pensions committee.
Well, we're hardly likely to be critical, are we? You're saying we are great, we know they're all great, yes, and you have a great independent chair. You couldn't better.
Do you think it captures the way
it does indeed. I should have probably been a little more serious.
Are you content with the two recommendations that you receive and approve the review and that you approve the proposed work plan?
Agreed.
So I will now please place that on the pensions committee agenda and I'll be required to attend and answer the questions of that committee. Pensions regulators assessment.
Thank you, Chair. This report provides an update of the funds assessment of compliance against the TPR code of practice number 14, which is attached as an exempt appendix to the report. The assessment is intended to provide assurance for the board of the effective administration of the pension funds. We established a traffic light self-assessment model to test compliance, which was considered at the board's meeting last June. Most areas were agreed with documentary evidence to support compliance, but a number of issues are made with an amber rating requiring improvements to the following areas in record keeping, maintaining contributions, providing information to members and IDRP processes. Since then, TPR have issued a compliance monitoring programme breaking down the code into consolidated tasks. We've used the simplified guide to retest compliance and improvements noted in 2.4 to monitor contributions, and the internal dispute process has increased the rating from amber to green in these areas. Although there have been improvements to record keeping and communications with members, these areas still retain an amber rating. The proposed developments required to target full compliance are noted within the exempt assessment output report. Under section 3, I note that we have completed the TPR online assessment to measure admin and governance standards. A copy of the results showing full accreditation in all areas is attached within the exempt section also. Thank you, Chair.
Welcome the fact that you're holding yourself to a very high standard on both record keeping and providing information to members, because you know we do know that if members' records are not correct, they don't get what they're entitled to. And the fact that you are holding yourself to the highest standard to make sure that is commended, and it is pleasing to see you're continuing to really be very, very rigorous with yourself over this. Because I think it's far too easy sometimes for people to think that records are appropriate and correct, etc. Because of course records change every day and you've got 130,000 members. Yeah. So this is a hugely complicated issue, and therefore I do welcome the fact that you are really putting yourself to a very, very hard test.
We have made improvements, but we do acknowledge there's some way out to go. That's why
performance manual?
Yes, thank you. It is attached as an exempt appendix. The compliance manual sets out the powers, duties and responsibilities of officers in respect of financial services legislation and regulatory regimes relevant to MPF. Although we're not regulated by the Financial Conduct Authority, we do adopt, as best practice, FCA guidance, and as I say, we are subject to other areas of legislation and regulation. It's obviously a detailed compliance report, but I trust that it assures members that we do take compliance seriously.
Any questions? Content to receive the report?
Yes.
All compliance notes, but this is a problem report, these are in the exempt.
Yes. Yes, so the minutes of the working parties, a governance and risk working party and an investment monitoring working party which took place previously are attached as appendices to the report.
Intent to receive the government report?
Okay.
Item 13, I'll read the declaration. The following item contains exempt information and detail on 14 to 18 of the agenda, and the recommendation is that under section 100A, that was for the Local Government Act 1972, the public be excluded from the meeting due to consideration of the following items of business on the grounds that they involve the likely disclosure of exempt information as defined by the relevant paragraph, part 1 of schedule 12A, brackets has amended, brackets to that act. The public interest test has been applied in favour of exclusion.